So I think today's topic is about mainly gadgets. Probably every one of you might have one. If not, you'll probably be badgering your parents to get you one, especially the 14-year-olds. And then after the gadgets, we talk briefly about physical activity and how best to maintain it and why it is important. Then the third is about, you know, generally around COVID and COVID, you know, feelings around COVID. So I'll talk about it for about 20 to 30 minutes or so, and then open the floor for questions from staff, from kids. I don't know whether I can call you kids, but, you know, like young adults. Okay. So that's the plan. And we should finish in probably like 50 minutes to 1 hour or so. So I won't keep you too long because it's a Saturday morning. And the last place you want to be is, you know, sit and listen to some old man. Okay. And go back to gadgets. Yeah. Probably all of you are already having your gadgets next to the YouTube. You know, just mark present, put it on mute, and you know, play the games or you know, check your Facebook or Instagram feeds. But anyway, some of you who are listening, okay, thank you. So gadgets, you know, like most of you, like 14-year-olds, meaning like you probably would have born in, you know, 2006, the 17-year-olds probably in 2003. So yours is probably the first generation where by the time you were born, I think Apple was released on 2006, the first Apple phone with a touchscreen. Before that, we did have a lot of gadgets, but there was no gadget addiction because most of the gadgets were boring or you can't carry it from, you know, along with you all the time. Now, the first Apple iPhone, people start to kind of, you know, use it as an accessory, not just as a communication device, because it offered so much. Okay, then came Facebook, Instagram, all these apps that you see, they all were designed in a way to keep you hooked on it. It's designed to be addictive. So in case if any of the adults in your life are blaming you for your addiction, you can blame the companies. You know, they've used psychologists, okay, designed it in a such a way that, you know, whoever uses it will get addicted. It's very few people can actually, you know, resist the temptation of touching the phone all the time. The reason being, we have a chemical called dopamine in our brain, which usually secretes whenever there is a reward. So in older days, you get rewards, you know, once in a while. But the feeling of reward is so good, you know, we want it all the time. Like, you know, star athletes or people in the arts industry, you know, in the cinema, drama, or singers. You know, if you ask them what's the best thing that they like, they said the sound of the claps. Okay, because it's affirmation from others that you're good and that makes you feel good. And they use the same mechanism and put the like button. Okay, so people, you know, if anybody likes whatever you posted, you get the same dopamine hit. Okay, so okay, I think some might be talking, but it's okay. So the reason for the addiction is the constant need for dopamine hits from our brain. And what provides these dopamine hits? You name it, all the programs that you use would be providing you dopamine hits. If they are not providing you dopamine hits, you won't be using them. So young people, probably most of you are on Facebook or probably are on Instagram, might have WhatsApp or one of the other, you know, communication messenger systems. And then probably some of you would also be have, not some, almost everyone would be having a lot of video games. And this, again, all these video games are designed to be addictive. Why they design it to be addictive? Because the more you engage with their product, they can show that to the advertising companies and get more revenue. So if people just use Facebook to pass messages or Instagram to just post, the companies won't make as much money. You know, there is a tech saying, probably some of you would have heard it already, but I'll repeat it. That if you don't know, if you're not paying for a product, then you are the product. So all young people who are using it, your data is collected by these companies and they aggregate it and they sell it to advertising companies. So for example, now when you're talking, your phone is listening and you can even test it now, you know, like after this session is over, just, you know, keep your phone, you know, you don't even have to keep it switched on. Just keep your phone nearby and keep talking about Nike shoes for about 5 minutes. You know, I like this Nike shoe. I like that Nike shoe. I like the Air Jordan. And then 5 minutes later, you go and open your phone and you'll start see advertisements for Nike shoes. Okay. It's that sophisticated and that advanced. So, I'll repeat the point. These gadgets, not themselves, but the products that you use them are designed to be addictive. And the reason it is addictive is because our brain craves dopamine hits and these programs constantly supply you the dopamine hits. So either it's games, Instagram, Facebook, you name it. Okay, so this is the addiction side of it. But also it affects the mental health aspect because especially Facebook and Instagram, studies have shown, I think it first came in Germany, but then it has been repeated all over the world, that longer somebody spends on Facebook, the more depressed they are. People don't know whether depressed people watch Facebook for longer or watching or looking at Facebook longer makes you depressed. The reason is we all think that others have a great life. You know, if you look at Facebook feeds of all your friends and family members, they all seem to have a great time. You know, they're either, I mean, not during COVID, I suppose, but generally, you know, they are on exotic locations having great time or, you know, nice restaurants. You know, it's, everything looks very polished, smooth, great. Whereas your own life, you seem to be stuck, you know, with parents who are shouting at you, teachers who are constantly demanding things. You know, you have homework that's pending, exam stress. You know, the holidays that you go to doesn't seem to be as glamorous. And this is a sense that's constantly being seen. You know, people feel that their life is not good, but everybody else's life is great. And that's what leads to a sense of feeling down, sense of feeling, you know, almost depressed. But if you go and check your own Facebook feed, okay, you see it as somebody from outside. Suddenly you will see your life is also great because in your own Facebook feed, you'll only be putting all the good things from your life. Yeah. So the nice places that you have been to, the nice restaurants you've been to, the good time that you spent with your friends. So if you're feeling down, stop looking at other people's Facebook own. And similarly with Instagram, you know, they're all targeted in a certain way and you are very young minds, very susceptible minds. I know Senjut's like one of the Jesuit priests, you know, long time ago said, you know, you give me a child at the age of 7 and I'll give you the man. So young age, formative years, you can be molded in a certain way. So you need to be very much aware of how your brain is being used by companies to exploit you. So that's about gadgets and addiction. I haven't touched on the games, but games are, you know, function of the same principle. It's just that games will have a lot of steps that you can grow from one to the next. And each step you cross, you'll feel a great thrill. And then the thing that doesn't stop, you know, you go from one to the other, one to the other. And then they'll introduce the idea of you have to pay to get extra skills or extra weapons or a more speedy car. And that's how they hook you in. Then you start to pay, you know, like either 50 rupees for whatever, then And similarly, it builds and then it goes to 1,000 rupees. Sometimes parents end up, you know, paying like extraordinary amounts without realizing that that kids have, because some of it, it's designed in such a stealthy way that you won't even know that you've already agreed to pay for all those things. Again, with games, be very careful, because you might actually lose a lot of money yourself, you know, without having to go and buy other things. So how best to deal with it? Okay. This is a very difficult task. I'll tell you why. As I said, you know, dopamine, it's like almost, it's being like a drug addict. If you imagine taking drugs from somebody off, how violent they'll be. Similarly, you know, I can imagine if your parents are listening, you know, coming and taking your gadget away when you're playing a game, you know, how difficult it is and how much of a monster you turn into. You start shouting, you start, you know, sometimes even abusive. In London, they opened the first internet addiction clinic 2 years ago. In China, every year, you can Google it, you know, after we finish the session, you can Google it. Every almost 5 to 10 young boys die playing video games. They wear nappies. You know, these are, I'm talking about young adults of your age, you know, sometimes even 18, 19, older ones. They wear nappies because they don't want to even want to go to the toilet to relieve themselves, because that might lose them some points. They wear nappies and they have, you know, tubes put in. Some of them even play with the IV drip on them. So they don't even have to get up and drink water or you know, eat food. So it's a serious thing. I'm not, you know, even though we are trying to keep it light, but gadget addiction is a serious issue. Some of you, even very clever young boys and girls, you'll see that your performance is dropping because you are spending more and more time on gadgets, on certain games or certain websites. Because they make you feel good for the 2 seconds or 5 seconds. So if you notice that, you know, these are crucial years, you know, 9, 10, 11, 12. If you notice you're not performing to your full potential, just check your phone. You'll know the reason. And how best to monitor it or how best to manage it. So you need to set a time of maybe maximum of 2 hours a day. It might seem very low to you, but, you know, young brains, anything more than that, you know, it all turns into mush. So put a limit for 2 hours, and within the 2 hours, you can use it for, you know, games, Facebook. I'm not saying that you shouldn't go into Facebook, you shouldn't go into Instagram, or you shouldn't play video games. You can do all those things, but with a certain limit. So maximum of 2 hours a day, and then you monitor what you spend the time on, then you can measure it. So the phones these days, they tell you, you know, you spent, you know, 30 minutes on Facebook, you know, 20 minutes on Instagram, you know, you played games for 1 hour. All those data is already in your phone. So monitor it and then try and put a limit. You know, first you put a 2 hour limit for the phone. Then you can put maybe a 15 or 20 minute limit on Facebook, 20 minute limit on Instagram, and then allow games for 1 hour, however you want it. Then try to keep it. So it's all about monitoring, setting a plan, and then keep monitoring it every week or even end of every day. All those data are in the phone. So I'm not against using all these new phones. I'm not against, you know, going to all these sites. It's just that you have to do it in moderation. That doesn't affect your studies and that doesn't affect your health. Forget even studies. You know, they actually make you depressed. So just to save your own mental health, you need to do it. Yeah. Or I might have to talk to your principal and talk to your parents to change all your phones into the old Nokia ones. Then there won't be any addiction. You'll be running away from those phones. So, okay. So now we'll move on to physical activity. Why physical activity is important? You know, it's not like, you know, everybody, although, young girls might prefer boys with six packs. I don't know. it's not for that. The physical activity is important because it actually improves your concentration and your academic ability. You actually perform better in your studies when you are physically active. And these are shown by repeated studies. It's not just my opinion. I'm talking about actual scientific studies where they show that a level of physical activity on a daily level improves your attention and concentration. And also, it improves your mood. So if you do minimum of 20 minutes, you know, you don't even have to go to a gym or, you know, go for a jog outside. Just in the same position where you are sitting now, you stand up and jump up and down for 10, 15 minutes or 5 minutes, have a break, then jump up and down for 5 minutes. If you don't feel like, you know, jumping up and down, you can get a skipping rope and you can skip. If not, you know, there's a, your young people, you can do this. You know, there's an exercise called burpees, B-U-R-P-E-E-S. It's just that, you know, jump and then you do a push-up and then you jump up and then you do push-up. It's a very hard exercise, but it will improve your, you know, cardiovascular fitness, aerobic, you know, muscle strengthening, all those things. So you don't need to go to a gym. You don't need weights. You can keep yourself fit. It also secretes chemicals called endorphins in your brain. They are natural feel-good chemicals that makes you feel more energetic, that makes you feel more upbeat. So 20 minutes of physical activity where you sweat, where your heart rate increases above 120, 130 or even 140, 150, that day you'll feel you're much better, much happier. Yeah. So physical activity, apart from the benefits of you know, physical fitness, it also improves your happiness. It also improves your attention concentration, thus helping you study better and perform better. Yeah. So try, you know, it's not people usually say, you know, like, I don't have time, or, you know, I don't have weights, I don't have gym access to gym, all those things. You know, you don't need any of those things. Physical activity is, you know, just very straightforward. Then it's about 10:45 now. Okay. I'll talk slightly more about COVID and just basics about COVID and then how it can impact. COVID is a virus, probably, you know, you would have been drilled into all these last 18 months or so, that spreads mainly through droplets, meaning when somebody is talking to you, there'll be micro droplets. Now, sometimes, you know, people speak and then you can actually see the splash, okay? But mostly it's all micro particles, and then they'll kind of reach into your nose, mouth, or through your mucosa in the eye. The eye is very limited, but mainly through mouth and nose, but even through eyes it can spread. And once it reaches your body, then it, you know, what's called an incubation period for about 3-4 days, you won't know any symptoms. It will be growing in the body. And for a lot of, you know, 85 out of 100 people, you won't notice any symptoms. It's called asymptomatic patients. But even asymptomatic people can spread it. That's why it becomes a pandemic. This particular virus becomes a pandemic, whereas other viruses don't. And some of you might develop symptoms after the fourth day, either headache, fever, and those symptoms usually subside in 2 to 3 days with just paracetamol. If it lasts longer, then probably you need to go and see a doctor and get it checked. The good news is probably now everybody is talking about third wave and how it might affect children more than the others. All these scare stories are being spread through. I think only last week, a study from Ames showed that they've done zero studies, and they've shown that young children are also affected the same level as adults. Basically, 65% of adults and 65% of young children seems to have been exposed to the virus. So even if we have third wave, it won't be disproportionately affecting young children, as it's been commented. So it's some good news. But at the same time, you need to be careful. So the point about droplet infection. Yeah. So how do you protect it? You protect it by wearing masks, because when you wear a mask, the droplet spread, it won't go that far because all the droplets will be filtered by your mask. And similarly, when the other person also wears the mask, so two people wearing mask, even if one person speaks and if some droplets spill through the mask, it won't reach that far. And even if it reaches, the mask in the other person's face would protect that person. So both people wearing masks, and at the same time, if you maintain the distance so that the droplets won't reach the other person, that way you are very much safe. The reason I'm talking to you is at the moment there are no vaccines for young people that's been available in India, even though it's available in US, and I think in UK they're trialing from 12-year-olds. So for you young people, it's very, very, very important that you wear your masks and make sure that whenever you are talking to somebody, the other person also wears a mask till we get the vaccines for you. So that might be, you know, the vaccine for 12 and above in India, I don't know, it might start end of the year. So you just need to be extra cautious. And if you're worried about mask, you know, you can also wear a face shield. A face shield is, you know, just a plastic sheet or a glass. So that will completely, it actually gives you 99% protection more than anything else. So they did studies last year, you know, a lot of doctors who were treating got infected, but a lot of them didn't. And they, what they found out was that even doctors with masks still somehow got infected because they have to be in close proximity. Whereas doctors who are wearing the face shield, you know, very, very, very rare for them to get infected. So if you're going out, especially if you're going to a slightly crowded place, then make sure that on top of the mask, you also wear a face shield. Yeah. Then this is the physical side of the COVID. Let's talk about the emotional side of it, because one, it's made you stuck at home. You know, we are all, you know, I'm sure you're all have studied science and how, you know, we all evolved from monkeys over thousands of hundreds of years ago. And if we have evolved from tigers, we would all be solitary animals. But monkeys, we know as social animals, they need other monkeys around to be happy. Especially, I think the children from plains who are climbing the hills after Medupalayam, you know, before you reach Kothagiri, I'm sure you would have seen enough, you know, group of families of monkeys. I've seen some people, you know, sometime, you know, they stop the car with bananas or whatever, and then some of the monkeys are so brave, you know, they even get onto the car, and you know, if you are not careful, they might even get in and come with you to St. Jude's. I think some of your teachers might think, some of you might have come through that route, but
we are living with them, doctor. We have hundreds of them in the campus, monkeys.
Oh, okay. So you have it in your camp itself. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you, oh, that's good. So if you observe them, you see them, how they are kind of, you know, very interactive with each other. They are kind of grooming and all things. So the point is, we are social animals. We need other ones around. And with COVID, we are all stuck inside. So you're all missing your friends, even though you might be talking to them over the phone or over Zoom, it's still not as good as interacting with them in person. Okay. So some of you might be missing your friends. So that can sometimes, you know, people feeling lonely, people feeling, sometimes even teasing each other, you know, the young boys and girls together, you know, teasing each other, that's also good fun. You know, so all those nice things are being missed. So that can have an emotional impact. Then the other side is about, you know, what's the point of studying? Because there doesn't seem to be any exam. Okay. So it's very difficult to motivate, you know, if you ask, and some of you are very, you know, like too smart for your own good, and you love all these, you know, very clever questions asking your parents and teachers, you know. But I think the purpose of study is not just for exams, you know. Even though exams are very important, you know, but you're learning because you want to learn concepts. And it's good to know these things. Because even as an adult, you'll find out, you know, suddenly you're in a job where basic chemistry, basic arithmetic, basic physics are very, very important to do your job. You might think, you know, I'm going to be a businessman, why do I need to worry about these things? But in your business line, you will be kind of coming across products that people can easily, you know, fool you if you don't know the basics of how that product functions, operates, you know. So studying for the purpose of gaining knowledge is more important than studying for the purpose of you know, exams. I know some of you may not believe me, but you know, once you're in your 30s and 40s, you'll know this. So if the easiest way to motivate yourself is just think about, you know, what actually interests you. You may not be interested in acquiring knowledge. You may not be interested in getting marks. Okay, but just, you know, what you're interested in. Okay, then you try to read about it. You try to learn about it. So then you will see how it's relevant to your own studies. So for somebody who's interested in music, if you check, excuse me, you know, how music is played, for example, you know, instruments. If you take instruments, you know, the seven notes, how each frequency, why the length of the string has to be certain for certain frequency sound to come up. And you know, and the material, the wood, the type of wood that instrument is in made in makes different sounds. And then if you are going to be vocal, how the vocal cords, you know, repeat. So you can always relate scientific subjects and other subjects to actually what you're interested in. That's what would make you an expert. You know, people just think, you know, I'm interested in music. Then if you talk to A.R. Rahman, for example, or Ilayaraja, probably they'll tell you more about, you know, the mechanics of sound and reproduction than your physics teacher, because they'll be so well. That's why they're so good. It's not just that they're talented. They also know all the areas that they need to know around the subject. So motivate yourself by actually, so you might think, you know, all these years I've studied things that I'm not interested. So this is your opportunity. You know, you're at home, you have your certain school tasks, but other times you're sitting on your own. You just think about, what, this is what I'm interested in. Let me actually look at what is involved. So that way you can still study, still acquire knowledge, but in your own way with your own interest. Then you can use it for your exams and you'll, you know, get all good grades. That's one way to motivate yourself. Then the last thing, okay, I'll finish on this point and then we can go to questions. Exams are very important, but they are not the be all and end all, because some of you might put yourself under too much pressure that if I don't do well this year, my life is over. Okay, people have this called what's called all or nothing thinking. Either everything is a success or everything is a failure. There's no in between. But it's very important for you all to, even though I think some of your parents and teachers might, you know, start to worry, you know, why did we invite the doctor? Okay, we are supposed to motivate them. He's asking them to relax. Okay. The studies have shown, you know, when do we perform at our level best? Yeah. It's when we are too relaxed, we don't perform to our level best. When we are too stressed, we don't perform to our level best. Okay, so it has to be the right level of stress, which is just a little bit. You need to be slightly anxious about exams and prepared, but don't make it too stressful to you. Because if you make it too stressful, what happens is, you know, you can't remember the things that you studied. Your brain can't think fast enough. The best example is, if you ask any of our Indian cricketers, you know, you ask them to come to your school ground, you throw them six balls, they'll hit all six into sixes. But the same person, you put them in a World Cup final, it's a last over, you got three balls. The pressure, it's called performance anxiety. Okay. So performance anxiety reduces your performance. So it's very important that you all don't get too stressed about exams. Okay, that's my last point. exams are important. You need to be slightly stressed, but not too stressed. That's not helping you or the school. So find ways to relax. If you're finding yourself, you know, getting overwhelmed by the thoughts, you know, talk to your teachers, talk to your parents. You know, they'll help you to relax a bit because they want you to be happy and healthy more than anything else. Okay. So all the best for you. And now I'll stop talking. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask me.
Doctor, I have a question.
Yes, please.
What we notice now, you know, it's more than 15 months now, you know, their children are under this pressure. We keep talking to them on Zoom and things like that, what you are telling, you know, apart from it, you know, like you should exercise for half an hour, be good to them and all. You know, the major complaint, what we are hearing from the parents, the children are becoming very arrogant and irritable and disrespect the parents and the people at home very badly, very badly. And this is
I just lost the sound a little bit. But yes, I mean, that's very much, and if we can actually check all this irritability, we will notice that it's all related to the gadgets. Not all, but most of it. Simply being because, as I said, you know, it's like, you know, if you take you know, alcohol from an alcohol addict or a drug from a drug addict, you know, how badly they'll react. The other thing is what's called instant gratification and delayed gratification. They want everything now. And, hello? Okay. So children, all of you are listening, you'll notice that, you know, after the session, you can Google and you can read about it. It's called concepts called instant gratification and delayed gratification. What it is instant gratification, like we all, when we are born, we all are driven by instant gratification. Whatever we want it immediately. So if you go and see a 9-month-old baby or a 1-year-old baby, or even the ones that they start to talk, you'll kind of see them cry, you know, I want it and I want it now. And they start to throw tantrums. Some of you probably are still like that. Okay. And that's because whatever we want it instantly. That's how our brain was designed. Then over the years, you learn to delay your gratification. Yes, you want it, but you want it later on. You can wait for a bit longer. So you want a new, you know, for example, you know, new iPhone or one of those things. And rather than immediately, your parents might say, okay, this year you get good grades and you'll get your phone. So that's called delayed gratification. You still get what you want, but it's delayed. And studies have shown children who are able to delay their gratification tend to be more successful in life. That's simply, you know, it's just common sense, you know. Say, for example, you know, now the India versus New Zealand, you know, the World Test Championship is happening. Some of you might want to watch it today itself. You might have a homework to be completed and submitted by Monday. So the ones who are able to finish the homework and then watch the match, no, they are the ones who have the ability to delay their gratification. But whereas some of you might think, you know what, I'll watch the match now itself and I'll do the homework later, where you get your gratification instantly, then you'll struggle a bit more. So this instant gratification, when it's not immediately met, children can become very irritable. The second is about the one I mentioned earlier about the gadgets. Because if you ask them to come off the gadgets, they become really, you know, very unpleasant. So the easiest way for parents to deal with that would be to give them, you know, like adequate warning. So if they want them to come off gadgets, first given intimation 30 minutes earlier. Say, like, you got 30 more minutes, and then we'll be taking the gadgets off. And then 15 minutes later, go and demand, give them a reminder, you got 15 more minutes, and then you got 5 more minutes, and 1 more minute. So their brain gets used to the idea of losing something that they're enjoying. So that way they are prepared for the bad news. But then right when it comes to that second, they'll ask, oh, please, oh, just 5 more minutes. Or, you know, they have all sorts of ways to extend it. Some of them might be angry and threaten their parents. Some of them would be very pleading. You know, some of them will be very, very cute. And, you know, they all have their ways of extending the time. So this is where the parents need to be more firm. So the reason is, if the children learn that they can extend their time by whatever means, they'll keep trying it. But once they know that if a parent says no, that's it. There's no point in, you know, pleading, cajoling, threatening, because they're not going to change their mind. Then there's no incentive for them to continue with that behavior. They'll only continue with that irritable behavior, arrogant behavior, because they're getting something out of it. So the parents need to monitor, okay, so that's the irritable behavior that they have seen. What happened before and what happens after? If they keep a log, they'll see a pattern emerging. That it's easy, it's usually around either they are being you know, asked to come to eat, or asked to study, or you know, asked to put their phone down. It's usually be these type of very common things. And they get irritated, they get abusive and all that. The other point, it might seem like all along I'm not telling what's the wrong with the young adults, but sometimes adults and parents also, we make mistakes. Because they are at an age now where it's a very tricky age. Because the rules of interaction are very clear between a child and a parent, and a child and an adult, and an adult and an adult. There are no ground rules for adolescent and adult interaction. The problem comes because the adults see adolescents as children, but the adolescents, they see themselves as adults. So they expect to be treated like an adult. So the reason being, again, you know, evolutionarily, the young adults are being at a stage where they're preparing themselves to become an adult, where they're forming their identity. The easiest way to form an identity is something different from your parents. So the minute, for example, you know, some of your 16-year-old boys who haven't taken a shower for a week, they themselves are not able to tolerate their smell. They have finally decided to go and have a shower. They have taken the towel, walking to the shower room. Suddenly, mom or dad asks, have you had your shower? That's it. They'll just walk back. They won't even enter the shower room. Because following an instruction given by an adult makes you like a child. And that's the last thing that they don't want to be. So to prove that they are adults, they'll kind of rebel. So the stage of rebellion happens at this age just for this particular reason. So if some of the parents, if they, you know, the parents do it out of care and concern, but how the young adults see it as being, they're being controlled. So how do we, as adults, communicate with young adults in a way that doesn't make them feel like children, and that we are not controlling their lives, we are not telling them what to do. And that's, you know, and each child will have a different way of dealing with it. And some of the teachers who are great teachers, you know, this particular age group teaching, you know, they have that skill either through, you know, like intuitively, or they worked it out. And those teachers have a way of, you know, even making the hardcore, the laziest child, you know, do more work, because they have a way of telling that the young person doesn't feel that they're being lectured to or advised on. So a lot of things young people need to change, and adults can help them change. And there are a few things that adults themselves can change by monitoring how they talk to the young person, how they tell the young person what to do.
we are facing is, as I told, I mentioned earlier, ours is a total residential school. So
It's all residential. Okay.
So what happens is, the minute they enter the school, their mindset is perfect for school.
Okay.
And you know, we had about 2.5 months wherein the government permitted the children of grade 9 to 12 to come to school, and many of them had come, and we had absolutely no problem with them, though I was dreading about how to get them out of this, you know, gadget addiction. But they were so sweet, I must tell. We told them to submit their mobiles and gadgets, and we were telling, you know, we have a schedule of how they, when they speak to the parent. So each class, you know, they were given certain time. And though I was really dreading, but we didn't have a problem. And they were compensating their, what you call, outflow of energy by going to the ground and playing, which they were missing for about a month. And I fully go by your words that, you know, the physical activity, sports, in my experience of being a teacher for, I'm going to just complete another couple of years, I'll be completing 50 years as a teacher, right? So I have seen the physical activity, the sports, definitely improves their concentration, performance, above all, their integrity, self-integrity, confidence. So the minute they came here, they went to the ground and they started playing. They were so thrilled that we had to call them back, saying that time for you to come for your shower, right? So we didn't have a problem when they are in school. But then again, when the government said close the school and they've gone home, I get calls from the parents saying that, is there any way in which you can take the child back? We'll give any kind of letter what you want. We are unable to handle them. So our problem is, parents, I won't blame them. They are being more protective. They don't want to hurt the children. And they fear that they might do something. Because I had occasions where some parents said, the child will lock the door after the gadget was asked to be, you know, they would lock the door and they didn't know what the child was doing, right? And about 4 or 5 hours, they were in panic. And then, you know, they fear about it. So they have a different kind of a, what you call, attitude when they're in school. And when they're at home, the attitude is very, 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 very different, which is hurting the parents. And I really feel so sorry for the parents. At the same time, I know why their children are like that. Because they are full of activity here. No time. Even from 5:30 in the morning, they are busy till 9:30. So how to help them when they are at home? That is my main, you know, concern.
Thank you, ma'am. I mean, like 50 years is a long time. I don't know how you haven't got burnt out, but, and I think you have your own.
A lot of enthusiasm. I want to do a lot more.
Okay. And it's wonderful to hear, you know, you have nice children who come and, you know, immediately take on the physical activity and behave. Because that's the thing about young adults, you know, most of them are clever enough to know how to behave depending on the situation. Parents are not here to defend themselves, so I can't, you know, like go too much into detail.
I see
one
or two parents. I can see Gayatri's father there. Yeah.
Okay. So, I think the first point, I repeat it again, is like adolescent is a very tricky period. It's a tricky period for the young people. It's a tricky period for the parents. Because we are preparing them into adulthood. There is a lot of responsibilities. It's the basic conflict is adolescents, they think themselves as adults and want to be independent. But parents, we see them as children that they need to be protected.
Exactly.
So all the attempts at protection is seen by them as us controlling them and not allowing them to be independent. So in clinical sessions, when I see these conflicts, you know, sometimes much more severe, so they come for sessions. It's to the young person, all I say is, if you can prove to your parents that you'll be safe, what way can you prove? Then they'll be more willing to allow you have to do things more on your own. And then to the parents, I ask them, okay, what should the young person do to convince you that they can manage certain things?
Okay.
So that you can allow themselves a bit more. So it's because that's the first time, because until adolescence, things would have been very smooth. Parents would be telling, children would behave. If some of the children who don't, they'll have the parents' mechanisms would manage. They might show a bit of tantrum and it'll be over by then. But in adolescence, a lot more factors are under play. So apart from the developmental stage, some of the young boys would be going through testosterone in their body. And that alone causes so much headache. The testosterone acts on the brain. It makes them a bit more reckless, a bit more impulsive. That's why, they want to, when they get a chance on, any vehicles, they go very fast. They don't drive normally. They just kind of, because their threat perception is affected. If we see road traffic accidents, it will be, most of it will be below the age of 25, 26. That's why insurance companies in the West, in the Western countries, you'll see the insurance is very high for young people. But the minute you cross the age of 25 and you go to 26, the premium comes down dramatically. So part of it is biological, part of it is social, part of it is what happens within the family communication. Because some families, we only know how to communicate through anger and shouting. When things are good, we don't know how to communicate. Everybody is quiet, everybody is doing their job. There is not much of, comfort, warmth, laughter, that's not that. So you only see emotions when things are difficult. And whatever difficult it might be, the only emotion that's shown is anger. So it's probably, when I was in England, we used to joke, every school will have a family therapist. It's because it's not mental illness as such, but it's just that how we communicate with each other. If that's looked at, I'm sure that most families can negotiate this particular stage with less damage. I remember my professor, he was Italian, Dr. Palazzi, he said, Kurunji, just because you have done child psychiatry for 20 years, don't think you can escape this dynamic. Okay, you would have to go through the pain too. There is nobody on earth who has escaped parenting an adolescent and getting them into adulthood without losing some of our... parents can have group therapy, they can share with each other. If they have good friends, they can talk to each other on how best they manage. The only point I want to make is not to see young adults as difficult or, inherently bad or, this is just, and that just sets them up. So we need to use whatever good that we can find in them. Even if it's 10% good and 90%, difficult behavior, we just use the 10% and build the 10 into 15 to 20 to 25 to 30. It's a process. Sometimes parents, the other point that I always tell parents is, if you want your child to change his or her behavior, it will only happen when you change your behavior. The problem is parents think that I do everything right. I don't have to change anything. It's only the children that need to change. I've never seen that work. Because adolescence, that's red rag to a bull.
They normally quote, we were...
Sorry, yours got but muted. Yeah, please.
Sorry. No, they always say, we were in your age, when we were there, we were doing this way, that way, and that irritates them more. Mm. Actually, Dr. Moda, for what you're saying, at least a major part of it, we are exercising in school. Actually, my policy in dealing with children is always to focus on that 10% or even 5% good in them.
Mm.
And it works wonders. It really works wonders. Mm. And we find an angel maybe appearing as a devil.
Yeah.
But, take away the outer casting. They are good. It's okay. My concern now is, how do we, you know, help the children now when they are at home? See, I cannot have a meeting with the parents and tell them, don't do this and that, you know, but I really want them, you know, to come out of this kind of, what can I call it, disasters all around, which is damaging their mental peace and their caliber.
No, it's very true, madam. It's the unfortunate thing is, you know, I'm happy to talk to parents, you know, I'll be the bad guy. We can you know, protect your organization from having to tell anything, you know, unpleasant, because some of the parents might take it very personally. You know, are you calling us bad parents? So it's nothing to do with being bad parent or bad parenting. It's just that the change, all the changes, if they understand what happens to the body and mind at this age, and why their sweet child has suddenly turned into this arrogant, irritable young person who doesn't respect, who shouts, who, you know. But then again, you know, if we ask the same parents, okay, what do your friends and family tell about your child? They'll say, oh, they always say, oh, no, he's such a nice boy, he behaves, you know, she's very sweet, she comes and helps. You know, it's only with me, doctor, they are being this. And then I tell them, okay, well, there is no harm. They have to take it out somewhere. It's okay. And as long as they are not causing trouble outside your home, okay, there's nothing wrong with your child. You can always sort it out.
Quite often we don't come to terms with our children, doctor. I think that's the major problem. You know, I'm a parent too, so I know it's quite difficult to come to terms with them. Well said by you, doctor. One little question that I have is, now that we are online, we don't get to meet the child face to face. So what happens is we tend to get to meet the child only online. Now, how do we maintain the concentration level, doctor? What is the concentration span of a child when he is on screen? And how do we bring about that concentration to the child?
It's, even if they listen for 5 minutes, that will be a big task. Because there are so many things to distract them around. Unless the child themselves are very self-driven and self-motivated, you know, it's impossible. You know, the task at hand, you know, what teachers have to go through this year, kids have to go through this year, trying to teach through this online stuff, it will work for maybe 5% of the very self-driven children who have it in them. Now, if I was not one of those students, you know, for me, like, you know, just a slight noise that side, I would be kind of turning my head over. I used to get into, you know, head teacher's room, you know, like every week, at least once. And because I was a very distractible child, and, I understand their pain. That's in class with the teacher in front of you with the threat of being, you know, in those days they used to beat us with scale and everything. You know? So even with all those things, and they'll always make me sit in the first class just next to the first table, first thing just next to the teacher's table. Because that way, you know, and even then I would like just a little thing, you know, get distracted there with some sort of. So, to answer your question, there is no easy solution, unfortunately. You know, we just have to do the best we can. And that's why I talked about, you know, children reading and learning things that interest them. You know, that's the only way we can make them. Because reading is it's a boring process. It doesn't give you dopamine hits. I genuinely believe this generation, they are like, when they go to work, they can't think in long term. They can't plan anything in long term. Because everything runs on this instant gratification, instant dopamine hits. So for them to think about, you know, things, doing things that doesn't give them the dopamine hit, they're not willing to do it.
May I request you, doctor, to, you know, sometimes when you are free, to give a kind of a, you know, you being in the field, know how to motivate children, some kind of a techniques or some points from, you know, which they can adapt to get their concentration. It could be in the form of a, you know, a write-up or whatever.
What I do within my own family and what I've done to other, you know, sessions and plans is like, just one is to reintroduce books into their life.
Okay.
Because books, they are rewarding, but they are slow rewards. They are not supplying dopamine. So even initially they might struggle to read for 3 minutes, 5 minutes, you know, even if it's a novel like Harry Potter book or, you know, all those, yeah, or even young adult fiction, there are so many things now. It's a booming market in the West, so you can easily get books around about topics that they're interested in and make them sit and read those books. So, for example, the gadget can be used as a reward. Okay, if they finish 20 pages of a book, then they can get, you know, 1 hour or 30 minutes with a gadget, something like that. So one is book. And the other thing is to make them play chess. Because some of them might think it's boring and all those things. It doesn't matter, because it trains them to sit and then focus on things and think. Even if they play fast chess or, you know, speed chess, whatever, it doesn't matter. So the whole idea, the science behind it is we are training the brain to not constantly seek reward.
Okay.
And you can have rewards that are the slow burners. You know, you do still get a reward at the end. Reading a book gives you a reward. Playing chess gives you a reward, but the reward comes slowly at the end. You get it's a much more of a slow cooked, you get a satisfaction over there. And some young people would suddenly start to, you know, find themselves how interested they are in literature, because when they read novels, when they read, you know, even non-fiction, how a sentence is constructed, it gives them joy. So my suggestion would be books, chess, these are two simple things. And we use that. Initially, they will be very resistant to it. But then we tell them, okay, if you want your dopamine reward, you need to do this first. Build it initially, maybe try it for 15 minutes and then slowly build it. If they can sit and read a book for 1 hour themselves, then their brain would be okay. Then they will be able to concentrate in the classroom. Then they'll be able to do tasks where they have to write an essay or whatever. They can still sit and think and write, plan, execute all of those things.
We would certainly take this idea, Doctor, and I won't mind introducing a period of half an hour wherein we'll ask the children to take the books and read online, and the teachers can supervise also.
Yes, please, ma'am. And also, ma'am, like I can, you know, like after they read the book, we can ask them, you know, about, you know, people talk about emotional intelligence,
yeah,
as an essential skill. Yeah. The teachers can ask the students, okay, what each character must have felt like, thought like in that particular situation. So slowly we can help them relate how their behavior can impact their parents, okay, and how it might make them feel upset, and how they can do things to make their parents happy.
Okay.
So it's called, like, the best, it used to be part of drama therapy, but you know, it's just the children themselves can, when they read what a parent has gone through, and when they reflect on it in the classroom with other children and teachers, so when they talk more about it, they learn.
Okay. Anyway, we'll be meeting on next Saturday with the students of grade 6 to 8, Doctor. I think they will have a lot to ask you, because they have bundles of energy and restless to the core. Okay. So I've learned a lot, and I'm sure all of us,
yes,
they have benefited. Okay. And we feel a bit more confident to deal with the children's problem, ultimately making their life simple and happy.
Okay.
Thank you
very much, ma'am. Thank you very much for the opportunity. And good luck, all kids. You know, all the best. Enjoy your time.
Thank you.
Be nice to your parents. Okay. And your teachers, sir, too. They've been very good. Okay. Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye, all of you, children.
Thank you, teacher.
Bye, ma'am.
Bye, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, teachers.
Bye, ma'am.